Because that is where the strength comes from to enable you to resist the devil. Amen? Amen? Praise God. Praise God. You should set your affection on the things above according to the word of God and not on the things of this earth. Amen. Well, you may say, well, Pastor, I am saved. Not only that, I am sanctified. Not only that, I am baptized in the Holy Ghost. I'm a child of God. I know the truth. That doesn't exonerate you from temptation. You're still going to be tempted. Even Jesus was tempted. Why? Because he came in the form of the flesh, in the human body. Hallelujah. The dynamics to be tempted is real. It's real and it's true. So you and I ought to guard our lives against every form of temptation. Every form of temptation. The trouble that you have is that it's not like you cannot overcome, you can overcome. But the point is this, that you believe so much in recovery than maintaining your standard. During the last message, I was speaking about recovery. Many people say, I will do it and I will recover. Or if I made a mistake, God will forgive me and I will recover. Yeah, but it's costly. Remember the last time we talked so much about recovery. Recovery can be painful. Recovery can be embarrassing. Recovery takes time. Recovery can be shameful. Recovery, so much that we talked about recovery. You remember that? During the last message. Amen? And so if we're going to think about recovery, we should not settle on it. Recovery can cause a delay to vision. Recovery can render someone ineffective. Recovery can make you feel humiliated. Recovery can become an obstruction. Recovery can make you feel guilty. Recovery can make you become very skeptical about others. You are sensitive to negative past. You begin to feel bad about yourself. And recovery takes time. All of that about recovery. So my assurance to you this morning is not to bargain yourself depending on recovery, but to maintain a standard. Maintain a status for God. Praise God. Praise God. Because recovery can be dangerous. And let me say this. Recovery is not as important as restoration. Those are two different words. When Jesus Christ came, he didn't come and die so that you can recover. He came and died so that you and I will be what? Fully what? Restored. Shalom. Nothing missing, nothing broken. That was what Jesus did. Hallelujah. In recovery, there is fear, but in restoration, there is peace. In recovery, there is shame, but in restoration, there is forgiveness. In recovery, there is pain. In restoration, there is gain. In recovery, hallelujah, there is a loss, but in restoration, there is completeness. Recovery is conditional. Restoration is unconditional. Recovery has a memory of the past. Oh my goodness. But restoration has a testimony of your future. In fact, no wonder the scripture says, as far as the east is from the west, so has God removed your iniquity away from you. He will never remember them no more. He will never remember them no more. No wonder Paul could say, in the midst of all that I'm going through, he says, I thank the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise God. He paid it all. He paid it all. Amen. Let me give you a few points. I want us to deal with this major, major issue. It's very important as to how we can deal with the battle within. How can we deal with the battles that we go through in our lives? Point number one, you must live a graceful life. Live a graceful life. Now, pay attention to this. Grace and mercy wasn't just an incident at Calvary. Oh, Jesus came and he died and he established us through grace and mercy and that's all. It's enough. No. Grace and mercy lives with us, abides with us unto eternity. So every day is a day of grace and mercy. As long as you live. Praise God. He says, live a graceful life. Number one, hallelujah. Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2. just after Timothy, the next book, I think is Titus, chapter 2. Are we there? Let's read verse 11, please. I'm going to read quickly. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation. What brought about our salvation? The grace of God. What has happened now? It had appeared to a few people, right? Some people, certain people, to all men. Doing what? The grace of God is a teacher. Now open your eyes and look at me. Whenever there is temptation, whenever there is trial, whenever there is this war within you, your flesh and your spirit, you turn to the grace of God. Can we all say, turn to the grace of God? One more time. Turn to the grace of God. Oh, I feel condemned. I feel nasty about myself. I feel so bad because of this and that. No, 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 no. Don't condemn. Don't curse. Don't accuse yourself. Turn to the grace of God. The Bible says the grace of God has appeared unto all men. Now, why do we have to turn to the grace of God? Because the grace of God teaches us. He is a teacher. I refer to him as he, as a personality. The grace of God is a teacher. He says, teach us. He is teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live how? Soberly, number one. Number two, righteously, number three, and godly in this present world. So the grace of God helps you. The grace of God teaches you. The grace of God enables you to live how? Soberly, to live how? Godly. Not only that, to deny ungodliness, to deny worldly lust, to live soberly, to live righteously, to live godly in this present world. So the grace of God is not meant, it's not a license to sin, doesn't give you opportunity to go into sin. Oh, I have the grace of God. I'll use the grace of God when I sin against God. I'll use the grace of God. Then you become confident in sin. That is not what the scripture is saying. He's saying that it is the grace of God that taught me not to lie because I used to lie. It is his grace of God that taught me how to say no to my flesh, that taught me how to say no to my feelings, that taught me how to say no to my anger, that taught me how to say no to my lust, that taught me how to say no to jealousy and bitterness. When that thing of sin showed up, the grace of God said, not like this. Do it this way, go that way, stop doing that. How many times sometimes you're doing that which is wrong, nobody is there, but you know something is telling you you are wrong. It's the grace of God. It's the grace of God. It teaches you. You know, it is funny at times some of the way God speaks to me. Sometimes something that he will say to me, I'm like, I know it's not the devil, I know it's of God. But what is he doing to me? He's teaching me. Even you may have experienced that. You're going through certain things. The Lord is teaching you certain things. He says he is a teacher. Teach us that denying ungodliness. Those are things that are contrary to God's word. Worldly lust. And then the positive aspect is that we should live. He will show you how to live out soberly, righteously, godly in the present world. Or this present world. If you see a genuine Christian that enjoys the grace of God, watch the way they live their lives. They live the life that is in line with God's word. Those are the people that enjoy grace. The one that people are jumping, oh, I have the grace. Oh, the grace. No, no, no. That is not grace. Grace doesn't bring disgrace. Amen. Grace takes you away from disgrace. Grace gives you the opportunity that you've never had. Grace enables you to overcome. Grace empowers you to say no. Grace opens your eyes to see the traps of the enemy and jump away from it. It doesn't push you into sin. It takes you out from sin. Hallelujah. Verse 13 says, looking for that blessed hope and for the glorious appearing of the God, or the great God, put it that way, it says, the great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquities. You see that? And purifying unto himself a peculiar people, zealous for good works. The grace of God makes you live so right. You become so peculiar, so zealous, so God-fearing, so thirsty for the things of God, for the good works of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Verse 15 says, these things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 8 to 10. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 8 to 10. Just back up, you see 2 Timothy 1 page. Chapter 1, verse 8 to 10. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 8 to verse 10. Be not thou therefore ashamed. Are we there? Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of the Lord, nor of me in prison, nor of me his prisoner. But be thou partaker of the affections of the gospel according to the power of God. Amen. Be a partaker of that afflictions. Hallelujah. That discipline. Amen. Verse 9 says, let's read that together. Who had saved us? Who saved us? Jesus Christ. But how? Who had saved us and called us? Not a funny calling, not a careless calling, not something useless. This is holy. This takes the nature of God. We are called into a holy calling. Hallelujah. Called us with an holy calling. And he says, not according to our works. You see that? Your religiosity is not important. Because the Bible says, even your righteousness is as filthy rags before God. Amen. It says, but how? According to his own purpose and grace. So you are called according to two things. His purpose, that is his will. Number two, his grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. It is his grace. In fact, when you read some scriptures in the word of God, it will baffle your mind. The Bible says, it says, even before the foundation, that is what, in fact, we read here just now, right? But also it says, before the foundation of this earth, God decided to save you. He knew you were going to make mistakes. He knew you were going to mess up. But he says, I loved him anyway. I loved you anyway. I love her anyway. Praise God. So the Bible says that we are to live according to the grace of God. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 16. Just take note of that because of time. Point number two. I'm going to speed up. Number two. If we are going to live and succeed in the life that God wants us to live and overcome these battles in our lives, we must fight the good fight. 1 Timothy chapter 6 verse 12. Excuse me. 1 Timothy chapter 6. Still in Timothy. Chapter 6 verse 12. Are we there? Fight the good fight of faith. Listen, there are some bad fights and there are some good fights. You see that? There are some fights that you ought not to fight at all. Because if you fight those fightings, honestly, you're going to lose. It's obvious. Amen. Don't let a sister close the door behind you, a brother close the door behind you, and you begin to speak in tongues. Prevention is better than what? Stay away from it so you don't get into it. Hallelujah. So it says, fight the good fight. Amen. Fight the good fight of faith. It is a fight of faith, not unbelief, not doubt. It should be a fight of what? Faith, the good fight of faith. But not only that, it says here, lay hold on what? Eternal life. Lay hold on eternal life. Whereunto thou hast called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. Lay hold. Listen, you can lose money, but don't lose heaven. You can lose your houses, lose your cars, but don't lose eternal life. Hold on to eternal life. It bothers me. Some people say, I won't go to church again because of that. I don't like the way they sing in that church. No, okay. I don't like what happened. Me and that brother or that sister. No. Listen, forget about whatever transpired between you and brother and a sister. You're heading to heaven. Go to church. Serve God. Live for God. Please go. Listen, I don't like the way they roll their eyes when I enter there, the way they look at me. Listen, I'm not there for you. Whether you roll your eyes up and roll your eyes down, I'll still go there. I'm there to worship God. Praise God. I don't have the kind of clothes, the way they dress. No. You don't go to worship God with your clothing and stuff. No, all of those things are nonsense. You go there to live and glorify God. Even if you can put on a slippers, you can dress easy or whatever, whether gorgeous or casual, it doesn't matter. Just enter into the presence of God and be there and worship God. Praise God. The reason is this, because you do not want anyone to deviate your attention from the things of God. You do not want any man, any woman to hinder. Do you know how many times you've sinned against God? You know what and what you've done against God. The Bible says, if God will mark iniquity, who can stand? No wonder Jesus ended by saying, thou shalt love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your might, with all your strength, and with all your soul. And the next one is what? Love your neighbor. Then you say, no, God, don't go there, don't go there. Yes, he says, love your neighbor. And not only that, to make matters worse, he says, love those who curse you, those who despisefully use you. And he didn't stop there. He got on to the point to say, love your enemies. Ah, God, what's going on? Love your enemies. Say, me, I will never, God, if you know. No, God says, if you know what you have done to me, praise God. Holy Ghost is our paraclete, is our helper, is our guide. Amen. And we don't go into war without the Holy Ghost. You become a victim. You don't go into war without the Holy Ghost. Galatians, quickly, Galatians chapter 5 verse 16. Galatians 5, 16. You need the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. This I say then, he says, this I say then to the church in Galatia. He says, walk how? In the spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Walk in the spirit so that you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. When the disciples of Jesus were sleeping and mysterious things were going on the mount, when they were with Jesus, the three, Peter, James, and John, and Jesus came the first time they were sleeping, man, he was like, oh man, won't you watch with me for an hour? He came the second time, they were still sleeping. He says, oh goodness, look at the mystery that is going on. It is a time where in the Bible says Elisha showed up, Moses showed up at the mount there. It was a transfiguring moment wherein they were handing over the dispensation of the law to the Savior, and they were handing over the dispensation of the prophets to the Savior. They could not see. The only one that managed to see was Peter. He was like, but he was still sleepy. And Jesus said, Peter, what's going on? And Jesus ended up, he says, he says, the spirit truly or indeed is willing, but the problem is where? The flesh. You see, that's the battle. That's where we fight. Listen, if only you can focus on your flesh and forget about Satan, you'll be a master over sin or against sin. Just discipline your personal life. Praise God. You overcome in the name of Jesus Christ. The Holy Ghost is our booster. He boosts us up. Whenever we're down, he lifts us up. Hallelujah. He guards us. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 to verse 6, you can take note of that. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 to verse 6. And fourth point, stand your ground. Stand your ground. Stand your ground. Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. I'll read. Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. Stand therefore in the liberty. What is the word liberty? What is the meaning of that? Freedom. You are a free man. Don't go back into that trouble. He says, stand first, therefore, in the freedom wherewith Christ had made us free, and be not what? Entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Don't go back into it. Stay away. Hallelujah. Stand. Stand. So this time I said no. This time I will fight you. This time I will resist you, devil. This time it's not going to work. All your schism, your manipulation, and all the chapters you're unfolding against my life, I'll crush them in the name of Jesus. Amen. Number five, I love this one. Mortify your members. Mortify your members. Crush them. Deal with them. The appetite. Some of us, man, we are gluttonous. Very gluttonous. Cannot take care of ourselves and our appetites. Hallelujah. Colossians chapter 3 verse 5. Colossians chapter 3 verse 5. You want to pray, but you are gluttonous. You won't pray effectively. Colossians chapter 3 verse 5. Are we there? I'm going to read. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is adultery. For which thing's sake the wrath of God cometh upon the children of what? Disobedience. If you know that as a young man, your flesh is the problem, and you, every time you're dropping there, don't date nobody. Don't even go that way. But we mortify our members. If you know you're a professional liar, you used to lying, you are addicted to lying, to the extent that they actually, did you just wake up? You just woke up, you say, I don't know. And it's just natural. It comes, you know, you practice lying to the extent that it just comes naturally. Even when there's no reason for you to lie, you lie. You just lie. Then you know what you begin to do? You lie to begin to keep quiet. Shut up. Amen. They ask you a question. Before you respond, you think first. Even if you can say the 10 times, no problem. As long as you come out with the truth. You've lied to the extent that you've hurt yourself and you cannot be trusted anymore. He said, your members, which are upon the face of this earth, your flesh. Now, look at all the sins that are identified here. They have to do with the flesh. They all have to do with the flesh. Every one of them have to do with the flesh. Praise God. So deal with your members. Deal with your eyes. If you are a man, you cannot see a beautiful woman. You'll be looking and they're turning again. Until you kick something and you are falling, you're still looking. Keep your eyes to yourself. Some people touching. Some people, their hands are like steel. If they pass their hand like this, $1,000 gone, $500 gone, $200 gone, disappear. You must discipline yourself. Some people, is the temper. They cannot handle their temper. They break the TV, break this, break that, break everything in the house. It's now you're going to go back and pay for it. Why? Anger. Anger. Praise God. These are your members. You see this? You see, there's one word that keeps coming up. Members. Members. From Romans to Galatians to Corinthians, everyone, he talks about your members. Did you see anything about the devil there? Talking about yourself.